So are we ready to accept the foresight of Nobel laureate Paul Crutzen? In 2000, this amazing atmospheric chemist disrupted a scientific meeting and said, "Stop saying Holocene." He insisted that we had so altered the planetary system through our actions that we're no longer living in a Holocene world. The Holocene epoch is the interval of geologic time since the last ice age, about the last 12,000 years of relative environmental stability. Crutzen suggested using the prefix Anthropos to name this new epoch that we're living in. Anthropos meaning human. So to indicate that human agency had altered the planet. Fast forward to 2023. Washington Post reporter Tyler Austin Harper suggests that Barbie and Oppenheimer are actually telling the same terrible message. I'd like to go a step further and suggest that Barbenheimer actually supports Paul Crutzen's theory, and it highlights the need for an Anthropocene epoch on the timescale. Our experimentation with nuclear weapons left a legacy of all kinds of bomb fallout through the Cold War, and our dependence on petroleum since World War II has fueled the great acceleration of human industry that's emitted all kinds of greenhouse gases into our atmosphere, and it allowed the human population to quadruple in size. That's altered Earth subsystems like the atmosphere, the oceans, and the biosphere that are critical to our survival. Now, beyond pop culture references like Jurassic Park, most people don't really have any clue about geologic time. But for geologists, even though this chart might make your eyes glaze over, it's kind of like the periodic table for chemists. It helps us make sense of 4.6 billion years of Earth history and break that time up into intervals of geologic time whose boundaries are marked by major changes. And on this chart, on the right-hand side of the columns, you'll see little golden screw-like symbols, little golden spikes that identify the boundaries between those time intervals. So at the very top of the time scale is the Quaternary period. That started about 2.5 million years ago, and it's currently divided into the Pleistocene and Holocene epochs. So the question is, was Crutzen right? Have we altered the planet so much that it warrants putting a new epoch on the top of this chart with Anthropos in its name? Our working group looked at 12 sites around the world, 12 very different sites, and found that indeed, that great acceleration of human industry has left its mark on all of these sites, and it's altered the way that the planet actually works, the way it behaves. So all 12 sites showed this impact, but we had to choose the best site, the one that best exemplifies those mid-20th century changes that altered the planet, what geologists would call the golden spike, to define that new epoch. That led to something kind of like a season of Survivor, but in the end, Crawford Lake near Toronto, which is the site I had long been studying, was chosen as the candidate site for the Anthropocene golden spike. So what makes this lake so special? Of all the sites we looked at, why this one? Well, it's a meromictic lake, which means that the waters in the bottom of this deep lake have no connection with the surface waters of the atmosphere. They're completely isolated, so the lake bed is completely undisturbed. Every summer when the water warms, little crystals of calcite form and they slowly fall through the water column and they accumulate as a white chalky layer on the bottom of the lake, and they cover the darker sediments that had accumulated over the rest of that year. That makes what we call a varve. And those layers, those varves, can be counted to identify each year, kind of like tree rings. So this is what those varves look like in the sediment core. So every light, dark, alternation is 1 year. And on the right-hand side, you can see the actual calendar years since 1952 for each of those alternations in the upper 17 centimeters of the sediment core from Crawford Lake. So Crawford Lake has many stories to tell and many different ways to tell them. This is beadwork by Elder Catherine Tamaro, and it weaves indigenous oral traditions, the traditions of the people who lived in the longhouses near the lake, with the stories that are told by the Varves about the environmental impact on our planet. We developed good relationships with the people whose ancestors lived around the lake, and because indigenous people believe that natural environments, natural entities, have personhood, traditional ceremonies to heal the wounds to the lake were performed whenever we removed sediments from the bottom of the lake. So Crawford Lake really is alive, not just with little organisms in the water column, but with history. And that perspective really helps me connect all the more with Crawford Lake and its sediment record. Most of the time we collected our cores from the ice surface. In the winter, typically, it provides a nice stable work platform for us to work from. But we were only able to do that in 2019 and in 2022. Ironically, global warming meant that in 2020, 2021, and 2023, safe ice didn't form on this Canadian lake. We needed more sediment to firm up our bid for the golden spike for the Anthropocene. So in 2023, because we didn't get safe ice, we had to get creative. We used a specialized raft platform, and we tethered it using long guy wires to trees on the shoreline because we couldn't disturb the lake bed with anchors. It's too precious. So in the center of the raft, there's a hole, and we lowered a metal sampler that is hollow and is filled with a slurry of super cold dry ice and ethanol. And it's lowered until it's just above the lake bed, and then it's allowed to free fall. And it sinks into the lake bed, and the layers of the sediment that had accumulated over the previous 1,000 years or so freeze onto the sampler. So after about 30 minutes, we lift the sampler back up, and those beautiful annual layers, those varves, show up glued to the sampler, frozen to the metal face. Once the precious core is transported back to shore via Zodiac, the frozen sediment is very carefully released from the cold metal face by pouring warm water into the center of it. You can see the dry ice sublimating. That frozen core face is then taken back to the lab where each year can be analyzed separately. We measured high concentrations of various pollutants in the sediments of Crawford Lake that can be dated precisely between the late 1940s and 1970s. That corresponds to the interval of the greatest impact on the lake. This is a spheroidal carbonaceous particle, or fly ash. Fly ash is produced by very high temperature combustion of fossil fuels, and these little particles look kind of like meteoroids under the scanning electron microscope. They look similar, but unlike meteoroids that can be almost the size of a small planet, these are 10 times smaller than a grain of salt. But the irony is that, like meteoroids, fly ash particles pose a threat to life on our planet. The potential for our planet to renew itself for remediation is powerful, though. And we can actually see that above the more impacted layer in Crawford Lake. So when Canada and the US implemented Clean Air Acts in the 1970s, shortly thereafter, in the layered sediments, we measure much lower concentrations of both lead and fly ash particles and other pollutants. So remediation is possible. We've had other successes, like banning nuclear weapons and substances like DDT and CFCs. And we've even remediated bodies of water that were declared dead, like Lake Erie, brought them back to life. So it's not too late to reverse the trajectory that started in the mid-20th century. I hope that adding an Anthropocene epoch to the timescale will wake us up to the impact that we've had on our planet and get us working more quickly together to solve that problem. This is your future we're talking about. It's the very near future. In fact, scientists predict that within the next 10 years, the ocean's capacity to take in a lot of excess heat will be exhausted, leaving us subject to even more rapid global warming. Crawford Lake will continue to monitor the health of our planet for at least another 10,000 years. What will future scientists find if they come and study the lake samples for evidence of how well we've done solving this crisis? It's up to you. It's up to all of us. Thank you.